The following From the Batcave special contains spoilers about Captain America Civil War.
Beautiful bicycle kick from Adzi!
Alright, so that worked a treat. Extra's gonna plan to be.
Going for the Pentakill, and here it is, Pentakill!
From the Batcave is proudly sponsored by AGTV. AGTV, the eSport Empire. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, other times of days where you have civil wars that aren't really wars and nothing really happens, and if anything it's more of an Afghanistan war than a civil war, if I'm being honest. Welcome to From the Batcave. I'm your host, Red Thunder Adam Gerard, and joining me as we decompress and decompact this film, the dad, no, Braden Ahert.
Hello.
The president, Adriana Allman.
How you doing?
And joining us for the first time live in the Batcave, it's Superfan himself, becoming Just Us League member, Bevan the Barbarian. And how are we this week, Bev?
Oh, not too bad.
Yeah? Going well?
Tired, but excited.
It's a good combination. How are you this week? Are you very excited?
Right.
I know you love this film.
I liked this film.
You love this film. And Prez, you going alright?
I like.
Yeah, I'm doing okay.
Yeah? Did you love this film as much as Braden did?
I don't think so.
I don't think anybody did, let's be honest. Yeah. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I should probably warn you right off the bat, I'm just about to launch into the pre-tape, which will explain the entire plot of this film. And then we're going to talk about the entire plot of this film. So that means the following will contain spoilers.
Captain America Civil War. The movie starts off with Cap and his team undercover attempting to find Skull and Crossbones, or whatever the hell the name of the guy that attempted to beat the shit out of Captain America in the elevator in the last Captain America film. Whatever his name is, they're attempting to find and stop him. He's driving a big ass garbage truck, ends up running into a bunch of shit, ultimately tries to self-destruct himself, and Scarlet Witch contains the explosion, attempts to throw him into space, but she's not quite powerful enough, blows up a building and a bunch of people die, and they're all like, oh no, we did it again, fuck, we keep good. Imagine if we couldn't blow up a building, that would be change, wouldn't it? Anyway, so, after that, Tony Stark is having a some sort of therapy session openly in front of MIT, and then gives away a bunch of grant money to all of them to show what a great guy he is. I guess he split up with Pepper because reasons. He's trying to leave MIT, and a black lady comes up to him and puts a photo on his chest of her dead son who was killed in the incident with Ultron. As we know from Iron Man 3, Tony Stark's Achilles heel is a dead son who is presented to him by the mother. It obviously causes a new kind of PTSD, and Tony Stark goes to find General Thunderbolt Ross. That's right, General Thunderbolt Ross, who you will remember from the Incredible Hulk film with Edward Norton, who openly set tanks on the Hulk in a college with children inside of it. Keep that in mind with you, because Tony Stark's all about keeping people safe in this film. So anyway, Stark and Ross basically call the Avengers together and tell them that they need to sign a treaty that says they'll do what they're told by the UN, which, as Steve points out, it's kind of bullshit, because then they can tell them not to go into places if they don't want to, and then that's basically an army, which the Avengers aren't. And they all have a bit of an argument, and then Steve gets a text message telling him Peggy's died, so he bugs off the funeral. And yeah, long story short, we end up at the UN for the signing. So they're going to go sign the agreements, and lo and behold, Bucky Barnes blows the bastard up, and T'Challa's father dies, and he takes on the mantle of Black Panther, vowing to kill Bucky Barnes. So, Cap being the guy he is, it's all like, you're not going after my friend, I'm Captain America, how about I punch you in the face instead? He goes to find Bucky, ultimately does, with the help of Falcon and his renegade misfit crew. And ultimately they have to go underground because, well, Black Panther's trying to kill him. So long story short, this upsets Tony, who decides that Cap's a criminal now, so they split the team in half, and Hawkeye turns up, and Ant-Man turns up. He's actually really good, probably the best part of the film, if I'm being honest. Paul Rudd, you said in an interview that that you didn't think you were as big a star, or you felt in awe of these other stars, mate, you were the best one in the film, so don't worry about it, you're the star. So anyway, yeah, Vision's with Tony, and then Tony goes off and is like, oh man, Pepper's not here, I better find somebody to bang, so he's scrolling through fucking Tinder, and ultimately comes across Aunt May, Marissa Tomei, is 51, would you believe it? 51! Look at that! 51! Unbelievable. Anyway, scrolling through Tinder, finds Aunt May, happens to work out at the same time that her nephew, obviously, he wants to get the fuck out of the house so we can get a bit of boning in on. Works out he's Spider-Man, so he's all like, hey, you should come work for me, I'll give you a better costume. And Spider-Man's like, well, I've got nothing else to do with my time, so sure. So they go off and they join a team, and then they head to an airport and have a big fight because one team wants Bucky, and ultimately Cap's like, nah, man, he's my buddy, I'm going to keep him safe, so fuck you. So they have a big fight, and Ant-Man becomes big and throws a truck, and it's accidentally a petrol truck and explodes. Hilarity ensues. And ultimately, the Vision, who you will remember is on Tony Stark's team, is all about keeping people safe and only blaming the people who should be blamed for accidents and mishaps. The Vision shoots, by accident, Rhodey, knocking him out of the sky. He falls for, has to be about 350 feet, and he's okay, don't worry about it, because the consequences are... Fuck that, the only one who dies Quicksilver, because he had blonde hair. Like, get out of here. Anyway, so, ultimately, with the help of Black Widow, Captain America and Bucky escape to fight another day, and, you know, more shit happens. There's some more punch-up, more drama, yada yada. In the meantime, Nemo, who is, I believe that was his name, Nemo, something like that. Okay, this bloke, there he is. He went to attempt to capture the codes that would reactivate the programming conditioned inside Manchurian Candidate Bucky Barnes. Very important we remember he's a Manchurian Candidate and therefore not actually in control of his actions because he's brainwashed. Even Tony Stark pointed that out. That's important for later. So anyway, he goes to try to get the codes. He gets the codes and you're like, yeah, got the codes. He programs Bucky to kill the Avengers. And Bucky goes a little bit mental. Ultimately, Steve's able to deprogram him, like you would imagine, because they're buddies. And yeah, it's revealed that Tony Stark's mum and dad, but his mum, Tony loves his mum, Tony Stark's mum was killed by Bucky, and even though 3 seconds earlier Tony was all like, Manchurian, I understand you're not to blame, he's all like, you killed my mum, Steve! So they have a bit more of a punch-up, and ultimately, yeah, Steve kicks the ever-loving shit out of Tony and is like, see, bitch, keep the shield, I'm out. And he and Bucky go off. Bucky is kept housed now by Black Panther to be kept safe, and Black Panther actually is cool with this because he himself, despite the fact his dad died literally like 2 minutes ago, is like, yes, I'll harbour him here and keep him safe. He's not to blame for his actions. Good guy, Black Panther. I'm glad to see that one person in a metal suit isn't a complete douche in this uniform, in this universe. And yeah, ultimately the movie ends with the Avengers all fractured and split up, and Captain America busting Hawkeye and Falcon and Scarlet Witch out of Tony Stark's ridiculous prison thing. It's obviously a hard prison to get into and get out of. You think it's some sort of mega supermax. And yeah, it ends with Tony Stark giving Peter Parker some sort of projection thingy put on the roof. It was, I guess, exciting, and yeah, if I'm honest, I'm pretty sure he's banging Aunt May. Anyway, back to you in the studio.
So, Captain America, Civil War. As I said in the intro, not a war, not really a civil war, not really civil, and as I just said in the pre-tape, Tony Stark can suck a dick. Thoughts?
Yeah. I second that. Tony Stark can suck a dick.
Yep.
Tony Stark can suck a bag of dicks.
I can see where he's coming from, but he's an idiot.
Oh, Bevan's more of a fucking fence sitter than you are, Brayden. This is unbelievable. I got two of you on my show. You just wanted me to bring him on so you'd look like a maverick in comparison. I'm onto your shit now.
That's it.
So you can see where Tony Stark is coming from. Let me ask you this, right? I'm going to pose a hypothetical question to you.
Sure.
Now, I go out tomorrow and buy a gun, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I go out the next day and I shoot somebody in the face. Yep. And all my friends have to come in and help me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it gets all cleaned up and I'm all like, whew, got off light with that one.
And then I take my gun out the next day and I shoot somebody, and like none of my friends come and save me, but my girlfriend does. And then I'm like, dodged a bullet on that one. Mm-hmm. You can pardon the pun. And then I go out the next day and I build an attachment to go onto my gun so the gun can fire itself, right? And then I go, so I could buy a second gun, because obviously I don't want to not have a gun. So I have a self-firing gun and I have my gun. And then I go out the next day with my gun and my self-firing gun, and they both go off and kill a bunch of people. And my friends have to come in and save the day, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's totally justifiable then if I walk in and go, right, none of you can have guns and you're not fucking trustworthy. Not one of you, not one of you knows how to responsibly handle a firearm. You're just making cock up after cock up. The cops are out there cleaning shit up. You're just menaces. Bunch of fucking menaces. That's Tony Stark's entire argument. He is the cause of every problem. Then he walks in like, you're all fucking loose cannons. You bunch of fucking wildcards.
He does admit to fuck it up. He does admit to being the
problem. He puts himself in the prison and the problem is solved. He's not making Ultrons. He's not fucking shit up. He's just sitting there like, wow, this is pretty easy. And Captain America's all like, yeah, I just solved all the crime because you went there to get in my way with your dumb fuck ego. Also, Tony, how come the only time you care about anything is when somebody slips a photo of a fucking kid that died in front of you? You're all like, this was your son? I must do something immediately. Iron Man 3, this is your son? Well, I had PTSD until now, and I know this is the best film, but I best do something now. This film, your son died in something that obviously, like, I killed heaps of people in? Oh my god! Fucking Steve Rogers! Fuck Tony Stark. Rant done for now. Continue.
You can start.
You can get yelled at first.
Yell at first. I will decide whether or not I wish to back you up.
I'm a big boy. I can take care of myself.
He says that now.
Have you ever heard of a term escalation?
No.
Okay.
Never in my life.
What happens when you have, say, a schoolyard
mm-hmm.
and a bully?
In the real world or in my world? Because in my world, all the nerds are like, let's get that fucker, and they kick the shit out of him.
Escalation. What then happens? Does the bully then go away, come back with a few more mates, and increase the problem?
Well, it depends.
Depends on the bully.
It depends on the bully, and it depends on, the, like, let's say I kill him. No?
Okay, well, let's go back
to... I mean, that's an escalation, sure, but...
Let's go back to the movie.
Yeah.
What is the sole cause of...
Tony Stark.
...those problems?
Tony Stark. Let's be real. It's Tony Stark. I'll go one further, because Tony Stark came from his dad's balls. Howard Stark. Howard Stark is the main reason for every fucking... Go back to the first Avenger! The cockhead's like, look at this glowing thing here. Want to have some fondue? Right? He's got the glow, and then the other Iron Man films, he's all dodgy, and he's when fucking Mad Men guy had his hair brown in Iron Man 3, and he's all like, yeah, make a new element.
Gonna okay, well, let's bring look it
to Howard Stark and the Starks. The Stark.
Power attracts power, and as you escalate the power, more powerful forces will rise to challenge it. That's one of the tenets that was actually asked in the movie.
Okay, I'll give you that, but then here is my only counter argument to the entire plot of this film. Okay?
Yep.
Who is writing out the treaty that Tony wants everybody to sign?
The Security Council of the UN.
100-something countries? Yeah.
The Security Council of the UN. Weren't they the same people who were like, yeah, we should launch some nukes at New York?
Yeah. But in their also launched them.
What I'm saying is, right,
120 million people dying in nukes versus 6.5 billion people being enslaved. That's a really easy math to calculate.
Okay, so if you're prepared to do that and you don't need a convention or a rule book to do that, how is that any different to the Avengers who, if in Age of Ultron they hadn't leveled that fucking city like a nuclear device, everybody would have been wiped out and enslaved. Therefore, is it not the exact same argument, therefore a pointless argument to have in the first place? Like, looking at the comic Civil War really makes sense as to why they have that Civil War.
Oh, I agree. The movie's terrible compared to the comic.
And this is the problem that I have is there is no plot. There is no nothing fucking happens in this movie. It's the most filler nothing nothing of consequence, no consequences, bubble-wrapped Marvel world that we fucking all live in, where they're just action figures, you can clash into each other, and nothing ever happens, right? You have this world where I don't understand how the consequences are cities get leveled.
Mm-hmm.
And their current answer to a worldwide invasion is, oh, we'll send out some nukes and level a city, which is the exact same thing. So why the fuck do you need a convention saying where the Avengers can and can't go when it's basically the same fucking process anyway? The outcome is the same as to whether you send a nuclear device or the Avengers. And I'll go one further. Yeah. If you don't fucking send Tony Stark in the first place and Tony can't make Ultron, this movie doesn't exist. If this had happened after Avengers 1, this is justifiable. Completely justifiable.
Yeah.
But happening after Ultron, it's fucking bullshit because he's the fucking problem. He is the escalating force since Avengers 1. He has been the non-stop escalating force, has been Tony Stark. He's the fucking villain.
So, would you think that Tony has learnt to be ethical?
No.
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 But he's meant to be representing ethical process now.
No. I know he's meant to be, but no. That's like saying Trump's... This is perfect allegory for their fucking election in that Tony Stark is Donald Trump and Captain America is Bernie Sanders and Iron Man just walks in and is like, he's a loser. He's got a stupid face, he's old, he's a loser.
Well, maybe that's more tied in with the comic, because that would be authoritarian versus what?
Well, the underground is meant to be... But we don't even get... The problem is, this is Civil War, and yet it seems like what is happening in the exact events after this is actually Civil War, in that Captain America now is at the underground. Like he says, when it fucking first happens in Civil War, he fucking gets him all underground with Fury, and then he's like, Tony, you're not going to find us, but if you need us, we'll be there.
Yeah, so
this is not Civil War. This is prelude to perhaps having a Civil War. This is Tony Stark. Fest. Tony Stark has poo diaper.
It's a slap fest.
Yeah.
I've seen better cat fights.
With no consequences.
In Ferris Class.
Let's talk consequences just quickly here and compare this to Batman vs. Superman. The film that the internet is apparently already just this thing shat all over Batman vs. Superman, which I disagree with. But Batman vs. Superman has a fucking consequence to it.
Oh, yeah.
This thing has, like I say, Rhodey falling about 300 feet into an impact crater, which you and I discussed off-air.
Why isn't he a doesn't work. Can of soup?
Yeah, why? He's liquid at that point. And yet, by the end of the film, he's a little bit gimpy, and as the president pointed out, he made the following fucking statement in the hospital, or in the I fell down Tony thing.
That's... Being dead would be better than being paralyzed.
At that sinking.
Well, I guess it's a shot across the bow at Oracle and DC.
So what I'm taking away from this, and then I am literally going to slide back and let Adriana and Braden have their civil war, as I'm just having mine with the film. I forgot my point now. Shit. I remembered it just because it's going to make you really mad right now. Ready?
Yeah.
Rhodey is the Felicity of the Marvel Universe now.
Because he couldn't walk and then he could, or...
Yep. And plus, he's got a really sweet costume now, just like she'll have a Black Canary costume that'll be dope.
No, she fucking won't. Alright?
So good, Braden.
She fucking won't.
Be so good.
Go there Felicity. And fucking murder her myself. She will not.
Oh, come on, you can imagine on Tumblr right now.
Felicinary.
Imagine the sex scenes they're putting out.
Felicinary, man. Woo! Anyway, Brad, we can talk about other used tampons like Felicity in Tony Stark, like you were saying.
Yeah, Adam's a massive bag of dicks. I mean, Tony Stark's a massive bag of dicks.
That's all right, Rhodey.
I do got to agree that there seems to be no consequences in this movie at all. No one died. I expected this to be the darkest of Marvel films. The amount of people and reviews and stuff I read, Captain America is pretty much the darkest of all the characters, in my opinion,
yep.
With the films.
Yep.
And I expected this to be the gateway to a dark Marvel universe. And it really wasn't. Like, I wanted to see, as much as I love Steve Rogers' Captain America, I wanted to see him dead at the end of this film.
I don't understand why Crossbones was in it, if not to kill him. What a fucking pointless waste. Crossbones is the guy who kills him in the comics. So why the fuck was he there? He was just there to be like, look at me explode.
He was a loose end in the previous movie.
Who was Crossbones?
Idiot mercenary.
Crossbones.
The burnt guy.
Yeah, the mercenary.
You know, shotgun shells in the arms.
Oh.
Blew himself up.
He was in it for like 2 seconds.
Yeah, and he was in the second Captain America film. He's the dude that Steve has the elevator fight with and kicks the shit out of.
Yeah.
His role was to blow up, blow his load, to say, and kill a few people, causing the Avengers to go, oh, that was a shame, and then get told off.
You mean his role was to do the Iron Man 3 Extremis explosion all over again because they haven't come up with a new plot. They just recycled the best film they've made and somehow turned it into the worst one they've made.
That was pretty fireworks for a romantic thing, which got thrown out the door because the actress didn't want to be involved in the series anymore.
Don't you dare belittle the masterpiece that is Iron Man 3 in my house.
I like you, Bevan.
I'm just saying, if she stuck around, maybe we'd have had a better plot this movie.
Oh, I agree with that. So hang on, you weren't saying Iron Man 3 was a bad film then?
No, I'm saying the exploding suits was just a firework display to backdrop a romantic
embrace. Yes, I will give you that.
Because of that, and because she buggered off to go, oh, I'm too rich now to do this and I don't like the guy, we need to find a solution. Well, what do you do? Yeah.
No, okay, I'll agree with you on that. But just to be clear, Iron Man 3 is a good film.
Well, let's be fair, in Iron Man 3, Pepper Potts is probably the best character.
I'm trying to process whether that is like when you just backhanded complimented the film, or if you're just being a dick. So, yeah, there's no, you were saying, no consequences. She gives you the shit too.
Yeah, no consequences. I liked what they did with some of the characters, but I mean, I haven't read Civil War comic. So I don't know it in depth, but I do have a basic understanding and knowledge of the way it runs and things like that.
You have brought so much clarity to Aunt May being so young when you're like, yeah, well, Gwyneth Paltrow was like, I'm out. Mr. Tomei would have been like, 20 movies? Fucking sign it in my own blood. Yes!
Think about it. The movie's what? Spider-Man Homecoming.
Yeah, by itself. The only one coming is going to be Tony, is that what you're saying?
No, what's the common thing happening at homecoming parades?
In the Spider-Man universe, the Green Goblin? Tell me more, I'm intrigued, Bevan. I want to see where this thread is going. I'm trying to unravel it, but all I'm picturing is literally what happens at a homecoming. Well, balloons and then a Spider-Man villain turning up and going.
Say a few dandelions will be plucked.
So we're going to see Kraven the Hunter? Is that what you... Is that what you're saying?
Would Tony Stark do May in his...
Yep, in her butt, even.
I was going to say in his Iron Man outfit.
I imagine it goes like...
You've seen the cod face.
Speaking of the Iron Man suit, I love the fact that as Tony's upgraded to have more panels, he's made it weaker, ultimately, and, like, Ant-Man's just able to be like, let me fuck your suit up, bro. And there's no, like, warning system that's like, you know, Friday's not like, oh, Mr. Stark, there's some fucking bastard riding around inside your suit. This is bullshit. But no,
his suit did.
No, it said...
Critical errors.
Yeah, critical errors, and it thought it was on fire, so it initiated the fire foam. Which, how the fuck does the suit work when it fills with flame?
It shouldn't have come out of, like, every single orifice. Yeah.
Shouldn't he look like that and be like, oh, shit, I just filled myself up with expansion foam.
He should be the marshmallow.
Maybe that's how fucking Rhodey survived. As he was falling, the suit just filled up with fucking expansion foam. So he's wrapped in, like, a cocoon of fucking posturpedic delight.
So I understand that, even 12 months ago, or whatever it was, when Marvel went through this big shoot with Sony to try and get Spider-Man because they needed Spider-Man for this story. They went, You know, it was all over social media. It was a huge fucking thing. They went going through all these deals. It was rumor after rumor and whatnot. And they got him, and they did nothing with him that was in the comic story.
No.
And they literally, when they were finished with him, just said, all right, you can go home now. If you don't go, I'm calling your aunt and telling her you're Spider-Man.
Do you know what the worst part
is? Like, all right, you're here. Now go home.
The worst part of, the hot aunt that is going to be Tony Stark's new love interest. That's the entire point of why she's there now. Like, in the comics, for those of you at home that don't know, in the comics, the victim of the Superhero Registration Act ultimately is Spider-Man. Because Tony Stark's already unmasked. Steve Rogers is already... everybody knows who Captain America is. The reason he's fighting is because, in his opinion, bullshit, they have to do this. And he sees it nothing more than... he remembers when they tattooed a bunch of people in Germany, and that was pretty fucking bad. So, Spider-Man and Tony Stark become great friends, and Tony gives him an Iron Spider suit and all this other shit to basically protect him. And then turns around, because he's groomed him, because Tony's kind of a creepy fucker in the comics as well. He grooms Spider-Man and basically says, all right, go out there and take your mask off now and tell the world who you are. So Peter does that. And the world falls to shit because his aunt's nearly killed. He's fired from the Bugle. His girlfriend breaks up. And like all this shit falls apart in his life. And Tony's just like, sucks to be you, doesn't it? Wish I knew what to tell you. And so ultimately at the end of the comic series, Captain America's dead. Tony Stark is kind of sitting there going, well, I learned a valuable lesson for all of this. And Peter Parker is just like, well, shit, I'm totally and completely fucked. That's Spider-Man's journey in the comics. In this one, his journey is, some shit happened to me and I'm Spider-Man and now I've got this suit. Isn't this suit great? Yeah, and, oh, Tony gave me something that projects on the roof. Ha, see ya.
Yeah.
Doesn't make sense.
That's what I mean. Like, this was supposed to be, in my eyes, and I'm sure I'm not the only one, supposed to be the darkest of the fucking Marvel movies, but because fucking Disney...
I saw it as the second.
Hey, Spider-Man!
I saw it was going to be the second darkest. Infinity War was always, in my opinion, going to be the darkest because Thanos is Thanos.
Well, what about the Thor series?
Yeah.
That's kind of getting dark, and what's happening in the third one?
That's true. I guess the second Thor did feel a bit more Games of Thrones-y.
Yeah.
Or medieval... for want of a better term. Yeah?
Literally, like, what was the second movie for Thor called?
Darkworld,
yeah.
Yeah.
And the third one's about the destruction of Valhalla, isn't it?
Asgard.
Yeah.
Well, it could be about two things. I mean, theoretically, this film's named Civil War, and it's not about Civil War,
it's
so...
Planet Hulk.
Considering Thor is called Ragnarok, and Ragnarok in the comic is Thor's clone who fights in the Civil War... is Thor's clone, who was made by Tony and Bruce. I imagine this one is probably, going to be about Planet Hulk.
Yeah.
Because it's a Thor film, so they'll be like, oh, we better include everybody.
That's a weird thought. Will it be a buddy cop situation doing that, though?
I think, personally, it's going to be a case of whatever. This is my theory on it, because it has to happen. It's obviously happening at the same time as Civil War. And I don't buy that Bruce Banner hears or sees that shit going on and just goes, I'm staying out of this. What I think happened is that, say Civil War takes place on a Wednesday,
mm-hmm.
right? On Monday, Thor starts and some shit gets real and Thor's like, I need my buddy, my big green buddy. So on Tuesday, he goes and finds Banner is like, I need your help, bro. And Bruce is like, yeah, well, there's nothing else fucking happening here. Let's go hang. And then on Wednesday, shit goes down. So eventually, Bruce is going to get back and be like, aw, man. Plus, Bruce has to be coming back, and we have to be getting Red Hulk, otherwise, why do you bring back Thunderbolt Ross?
Yeah. I see that Ragnarok is going to be a bit different to that. So isn't Ragnarok like another world or a hell, in a sense? I hear that it's...
In the actual Norse mythology, Ragnarok is the fall of Valhalla, which is basically...
It's when it gets swallowed.
Yeah, when the heavens fall.
Yeah.
So it'll be the destruction of Asgard.
My understanding that, I don't know, something happens on Asgard, I don't really know what. I believe Mjolnir gets destroyed, and he gets shoved off Asgard somehow, ends up on Ragnarok, which is where he finds Banner, who is Planet Hulk. He's Hulk and with Banner's brain and they fight together to get out of there to whatever. That
could be the greatest movie of all time. I want to talk about two. I want to compare Tony Stark's non-growth. In fact, he reverses his growth in this film compared with Black Panther's actual growth as a hero. If you'll indulge me momentarily.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So Tony Stark goes from, fuck it, we need to be under check, to, fuck it, I need to get Bucky, to actually, yeah, to literally, okay. Hey, man, he calls him Manchurian Candidate, literally proving he knows he's a Manchurian Candidate, and then 30 seconds later is like, you killed my mummy, I need to kill you now. It's like, what? That is the least heroic thing ever. You know he didn't kill your mum. He's the fucking gun. He's the... You don't get mad at the fucking... You don't go... Like, if Adriana comes in and shoots Bevan, I'm not going to go, give me the gun. Why? Why did you shoot Bevan, you fuck? That's literally what he's doing. Whereas Black Panther is all like... Throughout the entire film, Black Panther's just like, I'm going to kill that guy. And everybody... Steve's like, can you just listen to me for 30 seconds? And he's like, nope. No time to listen. Get out of my way, Red, White, and Blue. I gotta kill that guy. And then finally when he listens and he's like, wait a minute. He was programmed? That's terrible. I will protect him and harbor him and make sure that he can be found healthy because what he did was not his fault. And that dude's pain is like 2 days old.
Yes, but he represents blackness in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, doesn't he? As well
Falcon.
As Rhodes.
Falcon.
And Falcon. So...
Don't you come in here?
LL Cool J the second.
Yeah, LL Cool J and the green screen got a lot of work.
Versus okay, the white
yeah, okay,
guy.
Okay, I can see that, but I don't... Like, my argument to that is, okay, 2 days ago you killed my dad versus 35 years ago you killed my mum, and whilst yes it hurts, I literally just pointed out you're not to blame for anything. He absolved Bucky of everything he did until that moment.
It would also be weird being that it's Black Panther and it's just some weedy white dude in it.
Yeah, it would be a slap in the face of the actual Black Panthers in America.
Yeah.
Hmm. I was just going to say, talking about Tony's non-growth or inverse... yeah, pretty, like at the end of the movie, he was just sitting there just like, well... Yeah, just there was no resolution to what happened. He didn't even sit there going, well, I fucked up. He was just like, yeah, that happened.
Yeah.
Just rolls up in his car. Cool.
Pretty much. Like, the only reason he stopped is because he got the fucking shit beat out of him and his suit was
destroyed.
Broken down.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he would have kept going.
I love the fact, too, that he, like, tells Cap to leave the shield, and Cap's like, keep your fucking shield, mate. Stick it straight up your ass.
Yeah.
I wish they'd let him, I wish they'd let them swear just so he can be like, stick it up your ass, Tony, and just literally drop it at him. Like, there you go. Shit.
I did like Hawkeye.
Yeah, me too. He was pretty What I appreciated the most about Hawkeye, he'd grown a bit of a beard to hide a bit more of his fucked up head. If he could just, mate.
Just a whole beard.
Just a full beard and then cone the fucker upwards. Just fucking that way would be great. It's all I'm saying right now.
You can hold more arrows then.
Hey, listen, he only needs one with the way he fires. I'm sure it fucking boomerangs back around. Anyway, that's not to say the film isn't totally without fault. Adriana actually brought up what, in my opinion, is probably the best part of the film, and that is Paul Rudd's Ant-Man. Who what I wanted to see since... that's some good work. Since he appeared on the screen, I've been wanting to see Giant Man, because Giant Man, in my opinion, is always the most hilarious character, because theoretically, unstoppable, more unstoppable than the Hulk, since he can get as big as he wants, yet the fucker never is able to do jack shit.
Just his reaction when he grows, he's just like, whoa!
And all the physicists cringe because he's not freezing his ass off.
I think the best reaction was when he saw Steve Rogers. It was like, wow.
Yeah.
So anyway, so basic plot of the film is that King T'Challa is blown up when they're going to sign the fucking document. And Steve doesn't show up, by the way. Steve's all like, Tony, you can go suck that bag of dicks. Doesn't turn up. And everybody's all like, man, I wish Captain America was here. Yeah. So anyway, so then ultimately it appears Bucky just kind of walks in and is all like, should I blow this motherfucker up? Yeah, nothing else to do. Boom. And blows everybody up. So Black Panther's all like, I'm going to kill that man. And Tony Stark's all like, I'm going to kill that guy. And Steve's all like, I'm going to find my friend and find out what happened and actually do some investigation. Like, you know, a responsible-minded, non-fuckwit in a metal suit. So he goes and does some investigation, find Bucky. And, you know, as I said in the pre-tape, you know, Bucky's there. He's got his arm and he's all like, shit, Steve, I'm programmed by a nutcase. And so let's talk about that scene. Let's talk about, so they capture Bucky. They put him in a cell at S.H.I.E.L.D. And then the guy that's meant to be the psychiatrist is actually the programmer who programs Bucky. What do we think about that shit?
I don't know if I missed it somewhere, but who the fuck was that guy? I don't know if I missed it or it wasn't clear. But, like, I understand that he lost his family in some event. I don't really know what.
He's an intelligence operative.
Yeah, he in the comics, he's a S.H.I.E.L.D. operative.
He was a spy.
Not S.H.I.E.L.D. Hydra.
He was a spy in the country that lost a city.
He was a spy in the country that the Ultron event took place, and he lost his family. Okay. So he decided that he was going to destroy the Avengers, and the easiest way to destroy the Avengers is to set the Winter Soldier on them, because the Winter Soldier will not stop until he's killed everything in his path.
And compared to them, he's a nobody, a flea.
Yeah.
You don't attack someone with a flea; you attack someone with a knife from behind.
Yeah, exactly. You attack somebody with the unseen weapon.
Yeah.
So that was his purpose.
So he did what a spy would actually do.
Yeah, that I will admit, he was a pretty good bad guy. He ultimately turned Tony Stark villain. Tony Stark is the villain of this film.
Well, okay. To make your point even easier, Tony Stark is a tool. He's a Swiss Army knife.
He's a tool.
He's a Swiss Army knife.
Yeah, he's just a tool.
And who used the tool?
Yeah.
The spy.
Okay, yeah, I'll give you that. So, Tony is the gun.
Literally triggered him into trying to.
Tony, in the same way that Winter Soldier is the gun, Tony is the gun. I've got no argument with that. But then that makes it even stupider that literally the entire plot of this film is let the gun decide on gun control.
What do you call it? The agreement? It was there, but it wasn't the main focus.
The Superhuman Registration Act. And you vote no to it.
That was the thing that was supposed to divide them, and it did divide them, sort of. I mean, the Bucky thing divided them mostly as well. But then, at the end of it, that registration thing still, I guess, stood, and all the guys who were on Team Cap just became fugitives.
Yeah, which is pretty much the. I think I said this in our private chat. Or at least I know I said it to you. It's what happens at the end of Act 1 of Civil War.
Yeah.
No, it's not the end of the film. It's the end of the act.
So is Bucky going to get frozen again?
Yeah.
Good, because it's like, thanks for saving me. I'm going back to be frozen. Goodbye.
When they can deprogram him. But yeah, Bucky, in the comics, Steve Rogers dies. And Bucky Barnes becomes Captain America.
So
that would have been alright if they did that.
I actually theorize Steve dies at the end of Infinity War Part 2.
Steve Rogers dies. Tony then goes, fuck, I fucked up. We need to get rid of this registration act because the whole thing was a big mistake. Resolve it and move on. But no, Disney, no.
Do you know what you just wrote? What you just did there, Brayden? You literally, in your brain, you actually wrote the ending that they wrote originally to Civil War, which is Captain America is shot, and Tony Stark goes, I didn't want that. I fuck. And then, as it ultimately turns, he becomes the leader of the underground and Cap's on it. And then the S.H.I.E.L.D. is, the comics are awesome because the Punisher finds the dude who actually picks up Steve's mask and S.H.I.E.L.D. is the Punisher. And you think, like, as a reader, you're like, am I actually going to get to see the Punisher cruising around with the S.H.I.E.L.D.? But he doesn't. He takes it so that he can have the hood, which he uses to track down Crossbones, and then Punisher tortures and basically mutilates Crossbones. But he gives the S.H.I.E.L.D. to Barnes. I think he says something along the lines of, "I like, you're the only other man Steve would want to have this," or something like that. paraphrasing.
Well, he was a soldier, so that's his duty.
Yeah, and that's it. He's like, you were his lieutenant. And so Bucky takes on the shield.
But here's a question for you, Braden. Everyone who could wield the shield is in either jailed or now escaped and on the run.
No, there's one more.
Who?
Widow. Black Widow is...
she not get locked?
No, she's on Team Iron Man.
Yeah, but she also betrayed at the end.
She didn't get locked up, though. It's fucking Black Widow. She betrays everybody constantly.
Yeah.
She hasn't got the super serum in this one, does she?
No. I don't think she does she?
It's never been said whether she has.
Yeah, they haven't given us her background properly yet to know what the fuck her story is, but...
all we know is she's spayed.
Yeah, she's spayed and she's been trained since she was 4. But no, she has the ability to wield the shield, so there is still that option.
Does, but...
but, well, I mean, if you go by comic logic, she is the only Avenger that can throw the shield and lift the hammer.
Does she use both?
Not at the same time.
Vision could do both and hold both. That'd be excellent image.
Well, actually, movie Vision definitely would be able to do both, but I know that... I know in the comics, that's why the joke in Age of Ultron where she was like, oh, I don't need to be part of the dick measuring contest, is because in the comics she is just like, boom. The same way in the comics, Steve has lifted the hammer on occasion because when his will is strong enough, he can go...
when the need is just.
Yeah, exactly. It's that thing of like, when the hammer chooses to let you throw it, it'll let you throw it. But Black Widow always has the ability to throw it the same way Vision always has the ability to pick it up because they're both morally neutral. And we saw that from Black Widow in this film. She is morally neutral because she's on Tony's side for a logical reason. And then the second she starts seeing shit going south, she's like, okay, get on the plane.
She's probably the smartest character in that movie.
She's just been the smartest one throughout the entire series. Since Iron Man 2, she's been the smartest character. I mean, when you think about it, she's the only character to have ever played Tony Stark. I know this dude twisted Tony Stark. She played Tony Stark.
Yeah, I can see that.
So she is pretty, just like, she's more skilled than Nick Fury, is what that says to me. And Nick Fury, theoretically, is the most skilled dude. Speaking of that, where the fuck was Nick Fury? If any, the minute Cap goes underground, I expected the ending was Cap being like, if you need us, you'll be there, and then, you know, welcome to my abode, motherfucker. Like, you know, and then he's there hanging out with them. But no, he's just apparently just like, ah, shit. I need to make another Shaft movie.
They had, what, 2 after credit scenes?
And one was a fucking total waste. That Spider-Man one was a waste.
Now, they could have easily tacked on a very third short one of, like, 10 seconds, maybe, of Fury just pounding a beer or something.
Like I say, he's theoretically... I know I'm harping on this, but don't Marvel own the source material to Marvel Comics? They do, don't they? Right. So you would think one of them, Kevin Feige, I know you've read it. You were the editor on it when it came out. So if you could pick it up and read it, you might go, oh, fucking in the comic, all this logical shit happens. What if we put the logical shit? Crap. Like, it's just so redundant because you could have consequences. You could have more things happening. You could have better things. You could have better characters if you followed your own storylines. But they don't.
As I said before, they don't have enough characters to really justify it in called Civil War.
No. And it's not... Civil War... If you're going to do Civil War, it's a 2-part film.
And the Civil War is never civil.
No.
They're the bloodiest things known to man.
Yeah. Well, considering, like, the other thing as well is, for me, Braden, you're talking about you expect Steve Rogers to get a bullet in the head in this film, right?
Yeah.
Do you know, for me, that the person who's read the comics, I'm interested, you've read them all as well, haven't you, the Civil War series?
Yeah.
Okay. As I said, I went the full, took me fucking forever, but I did the full chronological Civil War, every comic that came out that year. And for me, the moment that stuck with me the most throughout the entire thing is not the death of Captain America. It's the moment that somebody blows a hole through Giant Man and kills him. Because that is the first moment that they all, like, it's in the middle of this huge battle. And he literally gets blown away and all the fighting stops because all the heroes are just like,
what the hell?
It's that moment of like where Scarlet Witch says to Hawkeye, you're pulling your punches.
Yeah.
They've all been pulling their punches with each other. I think it's actually Tony who blows the whole throne by memory. And it, and it's just this moment of where they're all kind of like, are you fucking kidding me? You just killed one of us. And like, it's an amazing turning point in the comics because it's the moment where Cap is just like, all right, Tony, I'm gonna fucking destroy you. I'm not going to kill you because I'm not you, but I'm going to destroy you. Whereas in this film, I would have, like, you almost had the reverse of that where when Rhodey should have died. Okay, if Rhodey had died, then Tony's rage, everything is justifiable. Because he can be like, you killed my best friend, you killed my mother years ago, that's not bad enough, you killed my best friend today, fuck you, you're taking everything from me. That I can understand. But the fact that, like, at the end of the film, he's just hanging out with Rhodey, just all like, oh yeah, aren't we bros? You're total bros, man. So glad we're bros. Yeah, nothing happened in this movie. So glad nothing bad happened.
I was honestly shocked with that scene because I watched the trailer about 15 times and the trailer explicitly showed him dying, mm-hmm. being shot by the Winter Soldier. It's like, what the hell just happened in the movie?
Mm. Marvel
did they cut it because they pussied out. Mouse
running
the job, so.
You know, oh yeah. The other thing I really don't like about this film is, and I know that like, you know, they only came out within a few months of each other, but you think you would look at it and go, we might need to rewrite a little bit of this, because that whole Superman, Batman, my mum's named Martha. Did we just become best friends? Let's build bunk beds.
Explaining before that this film didn't know whether it was a comedy or serious.
It's meant to be a tragedy.
What? Because the moments that were funny, but it just didn't fit the feel of what it should have been.
Sorry, that's what it was. That's what it was. Okay. So, Batman versus Superman, as I say, the moment is your mom's name Martha, my mom's name Martha, let's hug it out. Which comes from the opening scene, which is, this is my mom's name.
Yeah.
The opening to this film. I'm Tony Stark talking to MIT about this memory I had of my mum to show you how much I love my mum because I love my fucking mum. I haven't mentioned that I love my mum. I love my mum. Right? Mm-hmm. And then I guess the end of the film, you killed my mum.
I love my mum. You shouldn't have fucking killed her, man.
Right? So you think the screenwriters would be like, okay, the entire plot line of the first three films was,
I love my dad.
Man, I miss my dad.
I mean, I kind of hate him, but I love him.
But I miss my dad so much.
I haven't mentioned that I miss my dad. I miss my dad. All I want is my dad back. My dad.
You killed my mum! Oh, here's a little rewrite for you. He also killed his dad! The entire fucking plot point of the last three fucking films. Maybe he had him kill his dad and he went, hey, cunt, you killed me fucking dad. I love my dad. You wank stain. But I fucking take you, mate. I fucking jiff you. But no, instead he's all like,
haven't mentioned that I care about my mum until now, because fuck my mum, but I love my mum.
Yeah, but see.
Happy Mother's Day, mum.
That's what it is. They're bringing it out.
Hey, mum, you want to go see Captain America Civil War for Mother's Day? Iron Man loves his mum. She'll be right. Come on, mum. Happy Mother's Day. I love you, mum.
Yeah, gives me the shits. It's just the exact, like, I can't understand how you... They clearly looked at Batman versus Superman and went, whoa, people said it's not funny enough. Make sure we put jokes in ours. But didn't look at the other plot point and went, huh, exact same fucking movie. They told it better.
Maybe they got the CW writers in.
It would explain how Rhodey became Felicity.
Yeah.
I suppose we'll see.
Well, that is true. Well, it is a Disney film now, and you can only love mums in Disney films. Have you noticed that? There's never, like, there's single, normally single parents, and if it's a single parent dad, you're like, fuck you, dad.
What was the tagline for the movie died. Brave? Have you hugged your mum?
Was it really?
No, but everyone who came out with a review said, I came out and thought, have I hugged my mum recently? Have I hugged my mum recently?
Wow.
It was I Want to Hug My Mum movie.
But is that what they were going for here? Because, like I say, it's a couple of mishmash where it's like, okay, is this film meant to be I Love My Mum?
What do I love my dad?
Or is this film meant to be slightly comedic? Or is it meant to be hardcore? Like, am I meant to be sitting on the edge of my seat being like, is somebody going to die? Batman versus Superman, I literally sat on the edge of my seat for pretty much 90% of the film because I was like, The entire time through it, I felt the feeling something bad was going to happen throughout the entire film, which is a good thing as a first-time viewer when you're watching something like that that's meant to be suspenseful. You should be sitting there being like, why the fuck does it seem like Superman's going to kill Batman? Now why the fuck does it seem like Batman's going to kill Superman? Holy shit, he died? Whereas in this one, at no point, I'm sitting there, I'm just like, yeah, Rhodey's going to live. Yeah, nothing's going to happen. Oh, yeah, Black Panther's pissed off at Winter Soldier. That'll last to the last half hour. Then it'll be all like, probably didn't mean to. Like, you know what I mean?
Mm.
I didn't sit, Batman versus Superman, I never got ahead of the plot. At no point did I get ahead of the plot, but in this thing, I called this.
Right. The ending to the movie literally is the nerd who's been dumped.
Yep.
And has now lost his mom, so has no woman in his life.
Yep.
Goes on a rampage.
Yep.
And yet the black guy is the bigger man.
Yep. Well, you say that. No, there is a bit more resolution, because I'm sure Tony Stark is like, exactly the minute this film ends, is all like, yo, mate.
He's sending a text.
He doesn't have mates. His mates is fucking Rhodey, and Rhodey's fallen out the sky. So this is how.
How come no one set him up on a date?
Because he's a narcissistic piece of shit. Who are you going to set him up with?
Does that mean he actually dates the aunt?
The only person you can set him up with is another Winter Soldier whose mind has been wiped of any other fucking encounter she's had with Tony Stark. Here's what happened though. Literally, the third post-credit film for that scene is just Tony being like, "Hi, May. Well, I should probably tell her something.
I love my mum."
Yeah, it's good. "I love my mum, May. Would you like to love me like I love my mum?" Tony. If this film had ended, right, with Peter Parker walking in and being all like, "Spider-Man," like doing up his thing, walks through the front door and Tony's just like, "Oh, g'day, Pete. Me and May just here. Just go up to your room, mate.
Sure.
About to make some webbing of my own." Wait, surely. Didn't say that out loud.
He would be able to create like an ultimate sex bot.
Yeah, he did. It was called Ultron. And now he has the Vision. Why do you think the Vision's so weirdly loyal to him? Tony Stark is a fucking groomer, mate. He groomed the Vision and was all like, "Hey, Vision, I saw you pick up Thor's hammer. You want to pick up my Mjolnir?" Boom, 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 boom.
Well, you got to remember, what is Tony Stark when you take the armor off him?
A narcissistic piece of shit.
Narcissistic pedo.
He's just a lonely man, well, really.
Yeah, well, he's grooming Peter now.
Yeah, that's why he really wants the aunt, so he can spend more time around Peter.
Spider Gwen.
Yeah.
He couldn't have Tony groom her.
He wouldn't have groomed her, he just would have pounded her. I got a theory, right? Surely Steve Rogers' boner must just be so fucking strong. Because the Super Soldier Serum made everything, like, I'm not saying it's bigger. What I imagine
he
is...
He made his muscles bigger.
He was about this tall, right? So I don't think his dick got longer. What I'm picturing is he's got, like, a little dude who's, like, 5'4". The dick's maybe, like, this big, right?
He's got a coat.
But it's just, yeah, it's just fucking, like, out wide. It's got, like, a bicep to it. Yeah, it throbs. He can pick shit up with it.
Well, if all his muscles got bigger, that means he's got a stronger heart, which means he can have more pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's very good.
He can break the damn thing too.
Yeah, that was a much better Captain America film.
The first one,
yeah. Then this one, I mean, the second one is the best of the Captain America films.
Oh yeah,
Winter Soldier might be one of the best Marvel films. This one, definitely not. This. I'm putting it out on the table. I don't think I've said it yet tonight. Worst Marvel film of the series.
Disagree.
What's worse?
The first Hulk.
I'm in three.
You know what I'm gonna say there? You walked into that one. I'm in three.
But for legit, what's worse? Fuck off.
I'm in three.
Really?
Hang on. Which? I'm not talking. Angle East doesn't count.
You're talking recent.
You're talking Norton's Hulk.
Try and remember the timeline. Not the one that got We don't count the first one with the Aussie playing him.
Yeah, we don't count Eric Banner's one. The only thing we count from that is that's Harry became the Hulk. That's it. But yeah, no, it doesn't count until the Incredible Hulk.
So the one which had, you know, the guy got the bigger brain.
Yeah.
What happened to him?
They never made it a second Hulk film. Edward Norton fucking got Terrence Howarded the fuck out the door, mate. That's what happened to the big brain guy. They were like, let's just make people forget this shit happened. So yeah, no, when the timeline went Iron Man 1, Incredible Hulk, I want to say Captain America. No, I sorry, Iron Man, Incredible Hulk, Thor, Iron Man 2, Captain America, The Avengers.
Sounds about right.
Iron Man 3.
I really didn't like Thor.
You thought Thor was better than this? Or, sorry, worse than this?
Probably equal.
Are you just an anti-Natalie Portman person, or?
I just didn't like it. It was boring. I know it was setting things up, but it was like, you sit through and it's like, I'm just finished already. I really didn't like it.
Okay. That's how I felt with this. I gotta admit, that's how I felt with this film.
This one was pretty flaccid.
I think it was at the point where Hawkeye ended up in. Well, even where Hawkeye turned up, when Hawkeye turned up, not because he turned up, but literally at that point in the film, I was like, "All right, this has to be wrapping up, surely, surely." And it was still like another 45 fucking minutes.
Yeah, they expected to get a 2.5 hour movie. It's gonna, you know, they're gonna have a lot in it, but they just didn't.
And how many, like, even the fight, where you finally get the fight between them all, and they all just run at each other, and nothing happens. Nothing.
Yeah.
Except the only part in that entire thing that was entertaining was when Ant-Man accidentally threw the petrol truck instead of the water one. Like I say, Paul Rudd made this film. He's the best part of the film.
I must admit, I did actually like Spider-Man. I did like a wisecracking Spider-Man. They didn't use the character properly. But I did like him.
The shit talking Spider-Man as he's just kicking dudes' asses like he does in the comics for the distraction thing. I enjoyed that too. I like the fact he just got knocked the fuck out for being a little like for just getting too carried away. They distracted him with like, see ya.
Now, talking about Peter. His suit's mechanical now.
Yeah.
Is his webbing mechanical or is that a spasm?
No, I thought he had made web shooters.
Because didn't he shoot the door closed when he was wearing a t-shirt?
Yeah. I think he had the things on his wrist at that time as well.
Yeah, I thought it's not a big thing, it's like a Fitbit.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think he sort of wears it at all times, because I think he had them when he's in the after credit scene, when his Aunt May was putting the ice on his face and that, he had it on his wrist then and he wasn't Spider-Man.
No, that wasn't the web slinger. The thing he had in his wrist then was the thing Tony gave him, which is the Avengers communicator.
Oh, okay.
Or the shield communicator.
The Avengers that
which Tony only gave to him as an excuse to come in and bang out, mate. So he hit the ground, he was like, oh, it's just like jumping on a mattress.
No, he still would have gone all soupy, but then he would have mixed with the foam, and it would have become like a shape of him.
The only way that would have worked would have been if the armor created a stasis bubble around it.
Which you can't do.
Exactly.
See, that's why you don't send Spider-Man home. He could have been like, whoosh, saved him with a web, bro. You're welcome.
But then you have the same issue. It's like, what happens when Clark Kent catches Lois Lane? She should just go straight through the arms.
No, the web, though. The web works like a trampoline. So in theory, you can catch somebody before they hit the ground. They hit the trampoline and then are slowed. So he's not, like, he's still going to get hurt.
Yeah.
But he's not getting liquefied. Seriously, fuck this movie. Rhodey should not be alive. This is the part that makes me so mad. It's like you said, they lied to me. They lied to me in the trailer. They were like, Rhodey is dead. Like, Tony's all like, I'm going to kill somebody. Rhodey is dead. It's like...
wonder if we could sue them.
Nah, I'm just a bit gimpy, eh? I'm Rhodey. I wish I was dead. This is fucking shit. This shit, Tony. I've got to learn to walk again. Fucking hate this shit. It's a joke.
Don't you think the actual war veterans in America would be pissed at that scene where it was done?
Yeah, I...
Anybody
paralyzed who basically just got told, kill yourself if you can't walk. But there's your answer. There's the other Avenger, because by the next film, Rhodey will be up and flying again.
Yeah, well, this you don't really need your legs.
Well, the suit can do all the movement.
Yeah.
You just have to be a meat puppet inside it.
That's true.
Dance, Rhodey, dance.
Very well protected.
His legs are just like...
I'm just picturing them
and then
putting.
He crashes again.
Instead of having feet, they just put on like tank, you know, the tank treads. So he's just like rolling.
They've already
like a
had
Segway.
The suits fly by themselves. They don't need him in it.
Yeah.
He could just sit in a chair and have a thing on his head and go whee, fly it remotely.
I still think his legs flying around.
Literally. Tony did it in Iron Man 3.
Yeah, the best one. I will admit the one moment of Tony I did like was where he was in his plane and he's like, well, I'm leaving, and just like leant back in his suit and just got encased in the Iron Man, leant back in his chair, and the Iron Man suit's just like,
oh, from his helicopter.
Yeah, yeah. I thought that was cool. I was like, that was pretty cool. That was comic booky. And even like you could see in this film, all this film is there is to set up for the Infinity War. Anyway, that's why if you need us, call us. I don't know what this thing in my head is or how it would possibly be pulled from my head.
Or whether it controls me or...
Yeah. Like, all those things like that where it's like, okay, this is prelude to the Infinity War. Why the fuck did you call it Civil War? And honestly, the only reason I can think of that it's not called Captain America versus Iron Man is because Batman versus Superman was already on the books and they were like, ah, shit. Call it something else.
Mm.
But or conversely, it should have been an Avengers film. I know I bitched on this film, and I'll eat the tiniest bit of humble pie if ultimately I'm right and this is chapter one of 9 films. And the ultimate ending of all of this is the end of the Infinity War where the world goes, yeah, we need the Avengers. I'll eat the tiniest bit of crow because, wow, that was a good big plan. But as it stands as an individual film right now, it's a film where nothing happens and there is nothing set up. And like you go, yeah, the UN has the best of both worlds, but I'm the audience. I'm more important to you than the UN in your fucking fake universe. I don't have the best of both worlds. I have jack fucking shit.
So did you enjoy the movie at all? Because I enjoyed it, but I can criticize it from...
I enjoyed elements of it because I like Vision. Yep. I like the character of the Vision. I love Paul Bettany playing the Vision. I think that's perfect. I enjoyed Hawkeye, as Braden will attest to, being ironic as fuck. I actually enjoyed both Scarlet Witch and Black Widow. I like the fact the key characters, for the most part, if you take out Tony Stark, everybody grows in this film. Every single
Falcon was quite good too. Falcon. What? We haven't mentioned Falcon yet, and I really liked Falcon.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Even Falcon and Bucky. Look at the relationship. You can see Bucky is becoming the next Captain America. Just based on the when
can you move your thing forward? Nope.
Or when they're lying there and he's just like, I hate you.
Or in the car when
yeah,
Steve kisses.
That was my favorite moments like that. There are little moments. I love when Steve kisses Agent 13 and they're both in the car just like. So let's just rate this and final thoughts and be done with it. Have you got any Barbaras for this movie?
Oh, that's it. Just straight out Tony Stark.
Yeah. Yeah, Tony Stark.
Tony Stark.
Give it Barbara? Then if you're not going to give it to Tony...
Oh, I was going to give it to Tony anyway.
All right, cool. Fucking hell. All right. Cranston's. Let's throw it to Mo, see what he's got.
I'm actually going to give it to Falcon. I really liked... I liked the interaction between him, Cap, and also Winter Soldier as well.
Yep.
But I really liked him visually as well, and when he was in his action shots and the way he used his wings and everything was really cool.
He had the best use of humor in the film too, I reckon. With his little drone and all that sort of shit. Like his comic delivery is the best of anybody's in the film.
Yeah.
Which says to me when you're in there with Robert Downey Jr. and Clive Larson. Cranston?
Ant-Man.
Yeah, I figured you'd get Ant-Man.
Why
Ant-Man? Any particular reason?
He's just, I thought, the best character, and I thought he was the funniest, and character growth, I guess, literally. He knows how he can make himself really big,
mm-hmm.
and not pass out.
That was actually pretty funny.
Trying not to remember a certain comic book.
Eric Grayson.
I was going to give it to split in two. One to...
It's a pair of Aaron Pauls.
Yeah, Aaron Pauls.
Or Peter Allen's. As Matt likes to call them.
Ant-Man and Falcon.
And Falcon.
With honorable mention, just a little red droid.
What was the name of... What was that? I should know the name of the...
Red something, I think, wasn't it?
Red Wing?
Red Wing, the drone?
Red Wing?
Yeah, Red Wing. Yeah, it was Red Wing, yeah. Yeah.
Because I don't think me. I'm not talking to that thing.
come on. Just show it a little love. Give him a kiss.
He's cute.
Yeah, I'm going to have to give mine to Sebastian Shaw, a.k.a. the Winter Soldier, because he has the most growth of anybody in this film, and honestly, the parts where he... Perhaps I'm biased. I've done some research into Manchurian candidates and conditioning and mind programming and how
it's hard to act it.
Yeah, it's very hard to act that. It's even harder to act what happens to them when they come out. And when he comes out each time and he's like, what, and you can hear, because it happens to him twice, mm-hmm. and he gets heavier and heavier, like both times he gets darker, and he's just like, what the hell did I do? What did I do? And by the end where he's just like, it's, the world isn't safe with me on the planet at the moment.
Doesn't that also mean the program is beginning to fail if he's remembering more?
Oh, the reason the programming is failing is because of Steve Rogers. Steve Rogers is deprogramming him and deconstructing him because Bucky intrinsically can't hurt Steve. We've seen that even in the Winter Soldier. You can see he actually pulls.
Yeah.
Even in that final fight where he looks like he's killing Steve, he's not. He's pulling his punches because he's not using his metal arm. And so, to me, Bucky's the, you know, that actor, as I say, he just portrays that coming out and that, you know, the snap between the two, and even the like freak out where he's like, stop reading the code words, stop. Ready for, like in Russian where he's like, ready for a program or ready for assignment or whatever it is he says. That
ready
sort of
to
stuff
comply.
Is, ready to, yeah, ready to comply. That sort of stuff is perfect. And then he, you know, when he's not in those and he's more upbeat and he's more happy and, it, you know, you can see the
transition from an emotional to a blank slate.
Exactly. It's just so beautiful. And then, like I say, the character at the end, he's the only character who's self-aware enough to go, yeah, I'm a danger and a problem, so I need to be locked the fuck away until I can be fixed.
So shouldn't the perfect character stick with him be Black Widow because she's also programmed?
Yeah, but wherever you put Black Widow, she will find her. That's the problem with that, is that she is, ultimately, she's the undercover operative now. She's pretty much proved she's loyal to Steve. So she's Steve's eyes in S.H.I.E.L.D. at the moment. Or probably Nick Fury's eyes in S.H.I.E.L.D. at the moment is more than the point. But I think the character who should be staying with him is Steve. I understand why he's not. But with that said, I also think that part of that you will see in the Black Panther film is that he is with the right character.
They even said what the Black Panther is going to be about.
Which is why it's going to be about getting fucked. Because Black Panther isn't, I'm pretty sure now Black Panther is the one before Infinity.
That would make sense timeline-wise.
Yeah. So it makes sense that they want Bucky back, plus they're going to need Bucky in the Infinity War anyway. And yeah, so I would imagine that it may even be the start of the Thanos storyline begins in the Black Panther. Like, it'll begin in Guardians of the Galaxy, carry through Black Panther, and then the end of Black Panther will be Thanos arriving and going, well.
Well, we had Thanos already say.
He grabbed the gauntlet already.
Yeah, and get off his ass.
Yeah. But we don't know where that event took place in terms of the actual. Like I say, this shit, in my opinion, a lot of shit takes place on the same fucking day. So for all we know, this is happening while the Guardians are, or even Guardians of the Galaxy could take place in the future for all we know. Like, it could be two weeks further in the timeline than where we currently are.
It's just that we don't see Tony in that one.
Yeah, no shit. But yeah, I do think Guardians of the Galaxy has probably the most potential because that's where the story has to pick up. Like, Doctor Strange is obviously in it for a reason. I imagine he's probably the one who ripped the gauntlet apart. But Guardians is where it has to begin. Where this is weak is that it's the start of a new chapter, but they haven't given us anything tasty to carry over from the last one. It's like they're starting a new storyline with the characters. We like, that was book series one. This is now a new comic book, like kind of how comic books end and then you start the next one. This is the start of the next one, but they haven't actually addressed that. If there'd been a title card at the beginning that was like, you know,
5 years later. And they'd gone into the Civil War for a different reason that would make more sense. But the fact that it's just meant to be a couple of weeks, what feels like a month later. Mm. Like, where do any of these things take place? And how, you know, how long has it taken Thanos to get from wherever the fuck he is to Earth? Because by now, it's been like 2.5 years, theoretically, yeah, since Guardians of the Galaxy. How the fuck is he not here yet? All right, let's go. Thumbs up, thumbs down. Fence sitting, Braden.
I'm gonna give this two fingers up. Two thumbs up.
Two fingers up.
I'm gonna give it one down.
I'll go two up. Classic Aussie style.
All right. When I completely decompact this film, there is no resolution. The conflict isn't really conflict, because all it is two people who literally won't listen when somebody says, hey, can you just listen to me for a sec? In the end of it, nothing happens. Nobody dies because, well, we can't kill anybody. That would make it scary and fun. Like I say, the villain is kind of Tony Stark, kind of that German guy, and kind of Thunderbolt Ross, but also kind of none of them. And the hero is, I think, Bucky? I don't think Cap's the hero in this. I don't know if anybody's the hero in this. So, literally, this is a film for 2.5 hours where people run around going, I don't like you. I don't like you either. Well, come over here and say that. Come over here and say it to me, fucker. So, on that note, four thumbs down. I literally...
I love my mum.
I have watched every Marvel film at least 4 times. I have left every Marvel film and gone, I can't wait to watch that again. This, for me, is on par with The Dark Knight Rises. Wow. It's no Dick Lester's Superman 2, but it's on par with The Dark Knight Rises in that, like, the only reason I'm going to watch this again, I feel, is when I'm like, yeah, I'm going to watch all the Marvel films in order and get the whole story. That's the only reason I'm watching this again. Compare that to Guardians of the Galaxy. I bought the Guardians of the Galaxy Blu-ray, I want to say, 8 months ago, and I've watched it 8 times. Go ahead.
I was going to say that it was a red flag for me when I had 2 friends who have questionable tastes in films. We're like, oh, this movie's so good. I've seen it 3 times already. I'm like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
Wasn't as bad as I was thinking it was going to be, but once you've had a day or so to think about it, you're like, yeah, it was actually pretty average.
Like I say, once you have once you have a day or two to think about Superman versus, or Batman versus Superman, and you sit there and go, what has shit really happened in that? There were a lot of consequences, and by the end of it, every single person's life is changed pretty heavily. At the end of this film, everybody's just like Braden said, Tony's just sitting there like, well, shit, that happened. And yeah. Cap's just like, I got my buddies out. And if even fucking Falcon's face when he sees Cap is just like, well, shit, this is about to happen.
Did your kids like it, Braden?
They did, but in saying that, we asked them what their favourite part was at the end, and they said when Stan Lee called Tony Stark, Tony Stank.
That was actually pretty good, actually. Tony Stank.
Yeah,
maybe he deserved it.
Tony Stank, yeah. But yeah. I was going to say, maybe it seems like it caters more to kids. It's got Spider-Man who randomly comes in, it's all...
Well, Spider-Man is their tentpole character.
Iron Man. What a fucking stuff, and that's about it. That's all kids need.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, they wasted their tentpole, didn't they, Braden?
Yeah.
Like fucking hell. Okay. Before we wrap it up, here's then the big one coming out of this between you and me. We've started watching the fucking Spider-Man film, Bray. We've started that track for the show. Hasn't come out yet for the fans at home to see, but there's a spoiler for you coming up. Our Marvel Menzies and our fucking Spider-Man. After seeing this film, right, knowing what we're going to watch, knowing that we are having Spider-Man 3 and The Amazing Spider-Man 2 coming to us, right? Are you excited to see a Spider-Man film, or are you just like, I don't think this is going to be any different?
I'm not excited to see a Spider-Man film, but not because of this film. Because I feel like they're going to try and do something different. Obviously, Tony Stark's going to be in it, so I'm just like, eh, at this stage.
Tony Stark's going to try to do something different. May.
Yeah, but with the villain, like, I don't know. I just don't think it's going to be any different to what we've seen, and I'm just not that excited.
What do you mean no different to what we've seen?
Congratulations on graduating there, Peter. I love my mum.
Now, just before we do go, I did ask for people to send in their thoughts if they had any on this, and I do have one here from Martin Fitzpatrick, and his comments were: I enjoyed it. I thought Spider-Man was done really well, and as well, I'm looking forward to his new movie because of it. Overall, the movie was good and enjoyable, but it left a lot unfinished. My biggest annoyance was that whenever there was a change in location, the name of the place was plastered right in the middle of the screen, filling the whole screen and pretty much destroying any immersion in what was happening. I'd give it a 7 out of 10. You guys got any thoughts on that? Did the big-ass James Bond fucking title cards?
You got to sell vacation time, people.
Saying that did remind me of the camera work, the camera shots they did in the first scene, especially around Black Widow running through the streets. They were just so close to her, you couldn't see what was going on when she's running around. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah, they were. They're...
It felt like a Michael Bay Transformers with less CGI.
Yeah, I'll give you that. They did use all the stunt doubles, as you could see from the fact that there was that scene where Widow was where they're all chasing Bucky, and Widow's like taking out bands of people and jumping on bikes and shit. And there's like three shots of Scarlett Johansson's face, and the rest of it is just this person behind just fucking laying into people.
Did they turn her down? Like, I swear, there was less of her ass and her boobs were covered up.
I'm pretty sure
she's actually had a boob reduction.
What, ScarJo?
Which? Yeah, I'm pretty sure she has.
Probably surprised, but yeah, it's. I think they're doing it on purpose. I think they are trying to desexualize her because, the female role models in these films are non-existent. And Black Widow is the ultimate, like, the little girls, that's your ultimate fucking hero there if you're a girl.
Mm.
Like, if you want a female piece of empowerment, same way you have Wonder Woman in Batman vs. Superman, you have Black Widow. She's better than any of the fucking guys.
So will they bring in Femthor?
No. I don't think they will. I think no, like, they will get, will. I reckon
they
that they'll...
animated.
Yeah, they might.
You see them doing animated.
They'll bring up. I think you'll find that Black Widow.
In the TV series.
Yep, Black Widow is going to get expanded a lot more. Now I think her character is going to get a lot of growth from this point out.
Is there someone is there any character she hasn't dated yet in the movies?
She hasn't dated Hawkeye.
I thought they were dating.
No, that's what you're meant to think.
Friends.
That's what you're meant to think in the first one, but it's just the fact that those two are they've been through so much shit together.
Yeah, they're
Riggs and Murta. So go around the room. For me, this is just if you've seen the other Marvel films and you plan to watch the rest, watch it. If you're like, should I watch this movie? No. Don't watch it from me.
Yeah, I'm the same. If you're not really committed to the movies at all, you can easily miss this.
Take your kids to it. That's about it.
Look, it's fun. It's fun and the characters are enjoyable, but as a story... Nah. And like I said, I have very basic knowledge of the comic book, and I can confidently say that this is nothing like the comic book.
No, it's not. Things, the comic books have little moments of humor put in them that are very clever that they could have done in this since they already got Spider-Man. Just throw some fucking money at Fox and have the one scene happens in the comics where I can't remember who turns up. They basically turn up at Charles's school, and I think it's Colossus and Wolverine walk out and are like, this isn't our fight. You tried to make us register once. If you try to make us register again, you'll see what mutants can do. Take your fight elsewhere, And if you bring it onto our doorstep, the X-Men will finish it. You don't even need that in the film. You simply have them roll up. Just do the Wolverine cameo we all want. Where you roll up to the gate, you try to open it, and he just goes, fuck off. And that's all you need. Literally, you get your one swear bomb in. You get Hugh Jackman in it, which guarantees you even more fucking money, you dense cunts. And then you can go further and further beyond that. But they just don't. It's like they're afraid to give, like, oh, if we give them exactly what's in the comics, they won't come and see it, and it won't be for kids. Well, it still can be. You can tone it down and still tell that story.
Or conversely, it's more like, well, we can't unmask Spider-Man in this because how are we going to make more money out of it by doing another movie when everybody knows who Spider-Man is?
Yeah, and it's dumb because you could have had a much better storyline where, yeah, the next film now is I'm 16 and now I've got to deal with the fact everybody also fucking knows I'm Spider-Man. That's a hell of a film.
Yeah, and it's something we wouldn't have seen before. They need to do something different.
Yeah, it's like they're walking down a path of going, well, they've already read it in the comics, so we can't do the comic storyline exactly, but we don't want to come up with a new idea. So what's a way that we can just make it bland, but sort of like the comic?
Why can't they just do the comic? Kids aren't going to read the old stuff.
Well, not only that, but let's look at something that theoretically you can say is aimed at kids. Harry Potter. The Harry Potter book series is theoretically aimed at kids.
Yeah, it's aimed at teens.
You're meant to read a book each year from 13 onwards, or is it
11? Yeah, year 8 onwards.
Yeah, you're meant to read a book onwards, right? So, in these books, the books grow with their audience. They get darker and they get more mature and they get older as they go along because your audience gets older with you.
Mature.
So we have two phases of Marvel films which are PG, which you can show to your kids. Why can't we start making it a little bit heavier and a little bit darker for those kids that are now, it's been over 10 years. Has it been over 10 years? Yeah, it has. Since Iron Man 1, it's been just about 10 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
So any kids who were, like, anybody under 8 isn't really processing to remember the Marvel films to, like, you know, to take them on, like, in the same way, you can watch Superman when you're 5 and all you know is good guy, bad guy. But you're not really...
Well, they're afraid to be DC.
Yeah, but you can still... Like, okay, so now you've got... So the 10-year-olds who watched Iron Man for the first time when they were 10 and now 20, these films are still great, but at some point they're going to be going, come on, man, I want something a bit... I want some meat.
And that's where you get things like Netflix series.
Okay, but how can you have a world, because they all exist in the same world, how can you have a world that's that level of heavy and dark, that exists in the same universe as this, but in this world it's like, there's not an episode of Daredevil where that fucker doesn't bleed pints. Yet in this thing, Rhodey drops in the sky and has a droplet of blood. And now I understand ratings, I understand things like that. I'm not a psychopath who's going, yeah, let's make an R-rated, fuck it, let's make it all R-rated. But what I am saying is, come on, push it. Kill a character. Just one. Because you know what? The ending of this film... Okay, let's say it's Rhodes. In fact, Brayden, there's your answer. You don't want to kill Captain America. You kill Rhodey at the end. You have Rhodey be the one who falls because of Tony's mistakes. Because Rhodey is like... Yeah. You know, the whole thing where Rhodey becomes the target, he's done, and then Tony is standing there holding War Machine's mask, just like, holy fuck.
Heck, they didn't even what have I done? Incorporating Greek mythology with Icarus.
Yep. Exactly.
Flew too high and wings melted.
Anything like that, just something that you know, so Tony has some reason to, but it just, it's just such a numb fucking ending. Like, at least Batman versus Superman ends either on a down or an upbeat, depending on which way you look at it, where the color and life has come back in and Superman's now coming back, the world's going to be great, or all of these people have had their life changed because they lost the glue that held them together. So either way, there's big change and there's shit. You sit there and go, where the fuck do you go from here? There's just endless possibilities. Where do you go from here? With this film, it's like, well, where do you go from here, and why do I care from this point out? Because if this is how they're going to be made from here on out, why do I care?
Absolutely the best Marvel movie so far still has to be Ant-Man. Funniest thing, most enjoyable, and best plot.
Yeah, the plot for Ant-Man is pretty good.
Ocean's 13 in that universe.
Yeah, you're right. I'll give you that.
And each other movie has had some sort of theme. What's this movie's theme? Theory, exactly. Ethics versus personal choice.
But it's not.
Yeah.
See, I think that's what I enjoyed about. I didn't like Ant-Man. The only thing I didn't like about Ant-Man was Yellowjacket.
Yeah.
I really didn't think that was a great villain, and I think that's why, to me, Guardians gets that little bit higher, because the storyline Guardians is Indiana Jones when you look at it, but Ronan is that little bit more powerful. The one thing I will give this film that they finally managed to stop doing, and that is, hey, all the heroes together, should we destroy a city to end the film?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm so glad it wasn't just let's blop everything CGI fest. I'm really glad about that. At least that fucking ending doesn't happen. It will happen in Infinity War. They
turned it down.
What's that?
They turned it down. They just destroyed an airport.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. Thank you so much for joining us. I've been your host, Red Thunder Adam Gerard, and joining me in this review of all things not Civil War have been the Aunt May Buster himself, the Dad Knight Braden Ahern.
Fuck Tony Stank.
Ant-Man's number one fan, the President Adriana Ullman.
Woo! Yeah!
Okay, and making his official From the Batcave Just Us League debut, the man, the myth, the legend, the other man who can, in fact, wield Captain America's shield. As a rhyme, you're welcome to use that yourselves at home. Bevan the Barbarian.
Under ruse.
Yeah. Don't watch this movie. Thank you very much, folks, and we'll see you all next time.
This has been Cabana Production.